Kriban, two systems. Okay. As usual,
My
backup.
Wi-Fi is very weak here.
Senthilnathan, traveling at his joined. Good.
Sakara, sir. Good morning, sir.
Muthukrishnan Kaname. Muthukrishnan there. Anyway, NS Ramachandran Tharwaru has joined. Our
Two
regular.
participants so far.
One
Three.
more minute, Kriba.
Yeah.
Another minute, we'll be ready. More or less ready. Around 73 participants. We'll get it filled up quickly.
ரேவி, எனக்கு கொஞ்சம் ஐஸ் வாட்டரும் ஒரு டம்ளர்ல ஒரு கண்ணாடி.
ஐஸ்
ஐஸ் வாட்டர்
வாட்டர்
கேக்குது.
Yeah, I think 11 o'clock I should be able to start. Yes, good. Please go ahead.
மார்னிங், குட் மார்னிங் ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ. வி வெல்கம் பேக் ஃபார் அவர் வீக்லி வெப்பைனா. ஃபர்ஸ்ட் கைண்ட் அக்செப்ட் அவர் நியூ இயர் கிரீட்டிங் ஃப்ரம் தமிழ்நாடு ஐஎஸ்சி. ஹாப்பி நியூ இயர் அண்ட் ப்ராஸ்பரஸ் நியூ இயர் டு ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ. அண்ட் ஐ வாண்ட் டு கன்வே ஒன் இம்பார்ட்டன்ட் மெசேஜ். அவர் லாஸ்ட் எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ், வி ஆர் வெரி ஹாப்பி அக்செப்டட் டு கண்டக்ட் திஸ் மீட்டிங்.
The voice is echoing.
No, it's okay.
We are very happy that Coimbatore branch has accepted to conduct this meeting. We thank our President Dr. Ganesan and Dr. Srinivasan. And one more thing is, we are going to celebrate our Pongal next week. So we wish you all of you a happy Pongal. And we recognize the presence of our past National President Dr. Chakrarao here, and our TC member Ganesh Prabhu sir. And our past Tamil Nadu ISA President Dr. Ganesh Kannan sir here. Thank you, sir. And as usual, I want to make some chat box rules. If you need credit hours for this program, please send your name alone by WhatsApp to this number. Kindly note down this number. Don't call this number or don't SMS your name. Send
Ready.
Your name only by WhatsApp. Okay. And in the chat box, do not type your name or mobile number or any other details in the chat box. It would be unnecessary disturbance to the speaker as well as for the chairperson to pick up the questions. So kindly cooperate with us. Chat box should be used only to type your questions alone. And many people have not downloaded their certificates of PG Conclave. This site will be closed today. So those who have not downloaded your certificate, please log in this website and download your certificate within today. So with this announcement, we will move on to our regular program. Now I invite our Coimbatore ISA President, Dr. Ganeshan, to give a welcome address. Dr. Ganeshan, sir, please.
Thank you, Dhrupagra.
Yeah.
As a president of Coimbatore ISA city branch, I welcome you all for this academic feast about medical legal issues in anesthesia. I, first of all, I thank Dr. Sudarshan to fix this topic. He only is a mentor for this topic. He suggested this topic is a very important one. And everybody will come across day-to-day activities. And I'll invite moderator, Dr. Shagar. And first speaker of the session, I'll invite Dr. Amar Nandakumar from KMCH. And not to forget, I invite advocate Mr. Charan from Chennai and Dr. S. N. Krishnamurthy from who is taking on questions in the panel discussions. not at the least, I'll invite all inquisitors like Dr. Subbaiya, Senthil, and moderator for that session, Dr. Sudarshan, Dr. Yagambra Krishnan, and of course all audiences who are all actively participating in this session. And I wish you all happy learning. And one more request for our advocates and Dr. S.N. Krishnamurthy, Dr. Charan. If the time permits, please explain about each legal terminologies. Everybody is well-versed with medical terminologies. I actually, when Sudarshan suggested about inquisitors, I searched in the dictionary. What do you mean? What is the meaning of that, first of all? And I came to know that it's a forceful inquiry of any questions or answers like that. I don't know what is that meaning. And I request our advocate, sir, and Dr. S.N. Krishnamurthy, who is my teacher in my post-graduation days and Madurai Medical College. I request them, if the time permits, like what do you mean by deposition of the legal issues and what is mean by defendants and what do you mean by juries and then what do you mean by some basic legal terminologies like that, prosecution, what do you mean prosecution side and what is mean by defendant side, and few basic things if our time permits. Okay, I don't want to take much time. I'll hand over to next speaker.
Thank you Dr. Ganeshan. Now I invite our state president Dr. Sudarshan to give the presidential address. Sudarshan, please.
Very good morning to all. Respected President of ISA Coimbatore, Dr. Ganesan, Secretary Dr. Srinivasan, Past President, Senior Past President Dr. Chakra Rao, sir, who has been consistently joining in most of our programs, and thank you very much, sir, for your presence here. Senior Past Presidents of ISA Tamil Nadu, Dr. Kannan, and other past presidents who has been here very regularly, and senior past presidents of the districts, and the invited experts for the day, Dr. S.N. Kesar and Dr. Charan, and of course our own Dr. Shekhar sir, head of the department Ganga Hospital, who accepted to be the moderating in the session today, and a very good morning to all of you. We had a small break post New Year weekend, so, and this will be the concluding meeting of our webinar series of this, the 17th one. All the branches have conducted, and it is the brainchild, as I said in the beginning, of brainchild of our secretary, Dr. Krabagar. Initially, we discussed that we should have regular meetings conducted by the state. He was the one instrumental suggesting that it should be the district-wise, so that each branch has the opportunity to host, and they are also encouraged to conduct meetings and regularly. I think a big applause to our secretary, Dr. Krabagaran, definitely has a big round of applause. And we have successfully concluded this 17 weeks. I think we had a big team. Not to forget our President-elect, Dr. Kumar, and the most important anchor, Dr. Edward, and our Edward Johnson academic coordinator, and our treasurer, Ratna Kumar. Our ISA Tamil Nadu team is pretty strong, not only just with a few of the names of us we mentioned, but also backed up by each and every district and secretary from every district city branch, and also the other members from various branches who have been really volunteering to give their lecture speakers. And then I thank all the moderators who have been with us for nearly 17 weeks. It's a long, long continuous effort from all of us. I think it was well received and well attended every week. And people like Dr. Chakra Rao, Dr. Kameshwar Rao, very regular attendance. Thank you, Dr. Kameshwar Rao, for your presence today also. And Dr. Uchail Babu sir and all the senior past presidents. There is no governing council member who has not attended any of our Tamil Nadu meeting, webinar meeting. So all the GC members from right from the president till the continuous GC members, all the GC members have attended past presidents, the president elect, everybody has been regularly attending. I thank all of you for this series, and we conclude with this week for this webinar series. But we will be doing a summit meeting shortly. Summit meeting means the conclusion of all these meetings. One day program we are proposing, that will be the next in the few weeks time. Maybe we will send you the details shortly. With that information, I thank all of you with the big folded hands, all the supporters, participants for over the past 17 weeks to give the strength and sort of enough encouragement for ISA Tamil Nadu office to continuously perform this educative initiative. And thank you so much for being with us. And I'm sure you will all be with us continuously and support our academic endeavors. Thank you so much. Over to Kripa. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sudarshan. Now we will move on to our academic program. Today also we have two important topics as usual. One is ultrasound guided upper limb block. You all very well know that ultrasound plays a very, very important role in our day-to-day practice. We can even practice without laryngoscope, but nowadays it is very difficult to practice without ultrasound. So we have one topic on that, first topic. And second thing, as our president said, medical legal issues of anesthetists, especially meant for anesthetists. So it's going to be a very lively, interactive session. And as our Dr. Ganeshan said, all the panelists have come prepared with a lot of questions. So we will, they will be bombarding the questions to the moderators. So we will wait and watch that program. Now I'll hand over the session to our academic coordinator, Dr. Edward Johnson, to take over. Edward, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Guruvar. I welcome you all for the 17th CME of the Tamil Nadu ISA, sponsored by Coimbatore City Branch. First, I wish to a happy new year to everyone. And today's program is different from other webinars. It is in this webinar, it is a mastermind of Sudarshan. I thank Sudarshan. It is different in that way that we have first session of video demonstration on upper limbs, and the second session is a panel discussion, which we have not discussed in the past CME. It is an interesting panel discussion on the medical legal issues. The first session video demonstration is by Dr. Amar, and our moderator is for the session is Dr. Sekar. Dr. Sekar is the HOD at Department of Anesthesiology of Ganga Hospital, Coimbatore. He has completed his MD anesthesia in 1995 in Kasturibai Medical College, Manipal. Since then, working in the Ganga Hospital Orthopedic Department, he has started the ultrasound guided nerve blocks in the year 2008 itself, and he has performed more than 1,000 cases of peripheral nerve blocks. Recently, his novel approach, that is the supra axillary block by the ultrasound guided, was published in the reputed journal, and his area of interest is spine and ultrasound. So coming to the second session, there is the panel discussion is chaired by Dr. Chikaran and Dr. Edison Krishnamurthy. The panel of experts are Dr. Sudarshan, the president of Tamil Nadu ISA, Dr. Subbaiah Sillayya, Dr. Kehambra Krishnan, Dr. Sendil Nathan, and Dr. Srinivasan. So the chairperson, Dr. Chikaran, is an expert in different medical and legal fields. He is a qualified medical legal expert with DL and MBBS degree, and he has a MBA degree and appointed as a reader in the hospital administration by Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University. He has also DCH and MS after degree, and he has written books on child care and won the Tamil Nadu Government Awards, and he has been the co-author for many books, and he is member of many government administrative committees, and he is a treasurer of IAP Tamil Nadu chapter, and he is a legal advisor for IMA and IAP. We welcome you, sir. The second chairperson is Dr. S.N. Krishnamurthy. He is a professor and HOD of Department of Anesthesiology, Sri Sathya Sai Medical College Hospital and Research Institute. He is medical superintendent of Sri Sathya Sai Medical College Hospital. He has completed his DPNB in 1990. He has completed Bachelor of General Law in Madurai Kamarajar University in 2008. He is a postgraduate diploma in Medical Law and Ethics in the National Law School of India University, Bangalore in 2009. He got MBA Hospital Administration from Anna University. He is my teacher when I am doing my MD/RSC in Madurai Medical College. We welcome you, sir. So with that introduction, we will go into the first session. I hand over the session to Dr. Sagar. Dr. Sagar, please.
Good morning to everybody. Welcome you for this 17th webinar of ISA Tamil Nadu, which is to be a glorious event every week being held. Today, let us have the upper limb videos demonstrated by Dr. Amar. Handing over to Dr. Amar.
Good morning, and rather good afternoon. I am Amar Nandakumar, consultant anesthesiologist at Kovai Medical Center and Hospital, Coimbatore. My topic of discussion today is a video demonstration of upper limb nerve blocks. Before beginning my lecture, I would like to thank the office bearers of ISA Tamil Nadu and Coimbatore for providing me this opportunity. My moderator for this session is Dr. Shekhar Chellaya, who is the head of the Department of Anesthesia at Ganga Hospital. I have no conflicts of interest. All videos used in this presentation are our original work, and I'd like to thank a few of my colleagues who provided me some clips for this presentation. Without wasting much time, let us move on to the presentation. Describing the anatomy of the brachial plexus is beyond the scope of this video presentation. We all know that brachial plexus is the one which supplies the upper limb, and it is formed from the roots of C5 to T1, which joins together to form the trunks, upper and middle and lower trunk, which again divides into two divisions, anterior and posterior division, and before joining them to form cords, which later gives to terminal branches. And we know that we perform brachial plexus at various levels. In the intraskeletal level, we block the nerve at the root level or at the trunk level. In the supraclavicular region, we block it at trunk and the division, and the infraclavicular we block at the cord level, and in the axillary blocks we block at the interior, we block the terminal branches. The name intraskeletal approach to brachial plexus, the name itself is self-explanatory. Here the local anesthetic is placed between the anterior and middle skeletal muscle. The things to know in the anatomy when performing this block is, you should know the anterior and middle skeletal muscles, you should know the nerve roots, clavicle and the vertebral artery. So where is it useful? Any procedure around the shoulder till the elbow, you can perform the intraskeletal block. Below the elbow, like forearm and hand procedures, the intraskeletal block is not so useful, or rather not recommended. When it is not indicated, apart from the usual contraindications for the nerve block, if patient has a severe pulmonary disease, either ipsilateral or contralateral nerve injuries, diaphragmatic paralysis, you should avoid doing the intraskeletal nerve block. Positioning is very important in performing this block. The patient should be in supine or semi-sitting position with head turned towards the opposite side, the contralateral side. The head rests on a small pillow with arm adducted at the side. Ergonomics is very important. The operator is positioned at the head end of the patient, and the ultrasound machine should be either directly in front of him or at the ipsilateral side where you are performing the block. The probe used is usually a high frequency linear probe. All the blocks which we perform in the upper limb, we usually use a high frequency linear probe because the depth is very less in the upper limb, and it gives you a good image when you do this. As I already mentioned, the areas of interest is the neck, and we see that from this picture, we know that the areas of interest in the midline are trachea, thyroid, carotid, internal jugular, the skeletal muscles, and the brachial plexus in between. So when we start scanning from the midline, you see that this is the midline, and the image is the scanning is started from the midline. The structure you are going to see is trachea in the middle, where you see the trachea here. The thyroid is around little lateral to the trachea, and you see the carotid artery. So you start moving scanning from the midline, and you start seeing carotid, jugular. The jugular is collapsible, whereas carotid is pulsatile and it doesn't collapse. The next structure you see immediately lateral to this is your antiskeletal muscle. See again the same image. So you see the carotid, which is in the midline, and you see the jugular, which is in the lateral, and you see the antiskeletal muscle, you see the middle skeletal muscle. In between the anterior skeletal and middle muscle, the skeletal muscle, you see the nerves. That's the nerve root. It's an interskeletal groove. You see that there's a groove between the antiskeletal muscle and middle skeletal muscle. There is a groove, and you see the classical stop plate sign of the interskeletal brachial plexus. So we can start scanning from the midline, or we can start scanning from the supraclavicular fossa and move towards the interskeletal groove. So here we have started in the supraclavicular fossa. You see the subclavian artery getting pulsatile, and you see a bunch of waves posterior to the, this is the lateral part. And if you start tracing out, you can see the stop plate sign in the interskeletal groove between the anterior and middle skeletal groove, middle skeletal muscle. For the sake of, because we are going to start playing videos, I'm going to tell always the blue dot which you see on the top, this is going to be the lateral. For all the videos, it's uniform. This, the blue dot is going to be the lateral of the image, and there is a small scan, a small picture here depicting what is the position of the patient. So as I mentioned, we can, once we see the nerve, we can approach the nerve either by in-plane approach or out-of-plane approach. In-plane approach, you use the needle, which it's in the direction of the ultrasound machine, in the same in-plane, it's in-plane with the ultrasound, and you see that the needle is coming from the lateral end, and it is going, reaching towards the nerve roots, and local anesthetic is being deposited there. Or we can approach the interskeletal groove in out of plane also. Out of plane is you just go perpendicular. You see that the needle is perpendicular to the, you in the middle point, it is away out of plane with the ultrasonic probe, and you see that the needle is going there, and you see the local anesthetic gets deposited around the interskeletal brachial plexus there. You see that the local anesthetic is deposited, and the nerve root starts appearing bright. And this is out of plane approach. So whenever you perform an interskeletal block, there are certain things in addition to whatever I have described. As I already mentioned, we can approach the interskeletal groove either from lateral or from medial side. But the important thing to remember when you approach from the lateral side is you have to take care of not to injure dorsal scapula or long thoracic nerve, which is inside the muscle. See here the. In the middle skeletal muscle, you see the dorsal scapular nerve. So we have to make sure that we don't injure the dorsal scapular nerve when you come from lateral side. We can also approach from medial to lateral, but we should be aware, as I already mentioned, the vascular structures are very close in the midline, the jugulars, the carotid, and it's very risky when you approach from medial to lateral. So we usually prefer approaching from lateral to medial side. See, the choice whether you do it in plane or out of plane is depends upon your expertise. Initially, you have to practice in dummies before you go and do it in the patient, and whatever comfortable you can use it. But the problem of doing an out of plane approach is the needle is not visualized, and the chance of needle injury or vascular puncture is very high. Always use a color doppler to avoid prior to doing the block, so it avoids vascular puncture. Because the inferior thyroid artery, vertebral artery, suprascapular artery, and transverse cervical artery, there are so many arteries which are very close to the interskeletal brachial plexus, to the brachial plexus in the interskeletal groove. So the most common side effects when you perform the interskeletal block are Hanau syndrome and phrenic nerve block, recurrent laryngeal nerve block. You see that when you see the image, you see on the anterior surface of the anterior skeletal muscle, you see the small tiny dot that is your phrenic nerve, which has been marked here as well as here. So that is the reason why when you come from anterior or from the medial side, the chance of you blocking the phrenic nerve is very high. So that's why we prefer coming from the lateral side in the in-plane block to avoid blocking the phrenic nerve. The complications of subarachnoid and epidural spread is also there, because particularly when you do an in-plane block and try to put a local anesthetic between the roots here, usually see 6 root is bifid. So you think that it is 2 different root and try to put a needle inside and try to inject the drug, it can spread into the epidural space and can cause complications. Always it is better to do a pre-scan before performing the intrascalene block, because aerations are very common in the intrascalene area. You see that C5, C6 root is inside the muscle plane, and here it is. Sometimes it is inside the muscle of anterior scalene. It can be anterior to anterior scalene muscle. And also, you always use a Doppler to see. It may look like a nerve, but when you put a collar, you can see that it's a pulsating vessel. So you always do a pre-scan prior to doing an intrascalene block. The next thing is supraclavicular approach to brachial plexus. The name is self-explanatory. We are approaching the nerve, brachial plexus, in the suprascapular area, supraclavicular area, and you are going to deposit the local anesthetic there. The anatomy is pretty much the same whether you do an intrascalene or supraclavicular, because that area is very small area. You see the sternocleidomastoid and the anterior scalene muscle, middle scalene muscle, and the plexus is coming in between. We also see a close relation of subclavian artery in relation with the plexus here. So whenever we perform supraclavicular approach to brachial plexus, we should also remember the things to have to remember is the clavicle also you have to remember. So when is it indicated? Pretty much any procedure in the upper limb can be done with the supraclavicular block, approach to brachial plexus block, and it can be compared with the spinal anesthesia of upper limb. So majority of the procedures around the hand, elbow, and even process in the shoulder can be done. When the thing is, if you give a little more larger volume, it can the drug can seep up to the intrascalene area and it can cause the blockage. Here again, the contraindications are the same. Any apart from the general absolute contraindications for nerve blocks, any damaged severe pulmonary disease and damage to the ipsilateral or contralateral diaphragm and phrenic nerve damage, you should avoid or not to do a supraclavicular approach of brachial plexus. Positioning is again the same thing. You have to keep the patient supine with the head turned to the contralateral side, with the arm adducted by the side. Instead, here when you do a supraclavicular approach, we can place a small roll under the shoulder, which increases the distance between the bed and the transducer, so that you have you can operate the needle in between posterior or lateral to the ultrasound probe. Operator can stand at the head end, and the ultrasound machine is ipsilateral to the side, directly in front of the operator or in the contralateral side. The important thing is your head should be neutral to the ultrasound machine. You should see directly the ultrasound machine rather than turning your neck, so otherwise it can cause strain on your neck. Again, the transducer used is a high frequency linear array transducer. The area of interest, like already mentioned, again the anterior muscle is getting inserted in the rib. So you see that between the anterior scalene and the middle scalene muscle, the brachial plexus is still there. But at the lower end of the brachial plexus, just anterior, you see the subclavian artery is located there. And this is the place where we are going to keep the ultrasound image, and you are going to see all the structures. So the brachial plexus, the subclavian artery, the first rib and the pleura. So we are scanning from the midline. Again, the image is going to be the same thing. We are going to start scanning from the midline. This is the upper end, this is the head end. This is the lateral side. You start screening from the midline. You'll start, you're going to see the brachial plexus coming here. So this is the carotid, you see the jugular getting collapsed, you see the anterior skeletal muscle. You see that there is a subclavian artery is between the anti-scaling machine, and if you trace it down, you are going to trace it, you see that the supply vein artery is getting more and more round, and you see the posterior bunch of grades here. We can also reach the supraclavicular area by scanning from the intrascalene groove. So you start scanning from the intrascalene groove, you're going to get the same image. See here, we are, this is the stop light sign. You started scanning from there, you're going to scan towards the supraclavicular area. The nerve roots becomes the comes lateral to the artery, and this is the artery. This is round and circular and hypoechoic. Or sometimes you can directly scan the supraclavicular fossa rather than coming from the midline or coming from the intrascalene groove. You just keep the probe there in the just above the clavicle, you'll start seeing the supraclavicular fossa. So sonar anatomy, like already I mentioned, there is a close relation between pleura, the first rib, brachial plexus, and the subclavian artery. So the procedure, the out-of-plane approach of supraclavicular, you see that the needle is just out-of-plane into the ultrasound probe, and this is what you are going to see. Here out-of-plane, you are not be able to see the needle properly. The needle is just coming lateral to the artery, and the needle is being placed. So we are injecting a little bit of local anesthetic and causing a hydrodissection, and then you start injecting the drug. So here it is in plane supraclavicular. So the needle is coming in plane with the ultrasound probe. In the lower half, you are seeing the ultrasound, there is a little amount of local is being injected, and the local anesthetic is being placed in the anterior surface of the brachial plexus. So here you see that the local anesthetic is going to be placed in the posterior side of the brachial plexus, and you see that medially you can see carotid artery, non-carotid artery, subclavian artery. So when we do a supraclavicular approach to brachial plexus, we should make sure that you inject some amount of local anesthetic in the posterior counterpart of the subclavian artery. The reason why it is important is you see that the lateral trunk and branches of lateral trunk just lie posterior to the subclavian artery. So that is very important when you do a supraclavicular approach to brachial plexus, otherwise you will spare the ulnar nerve and branches of the lower trunk. See that the corner pocket is being injected, the artery is being lifted side, the other side. That is in plane approach. Here it is in out of plane. That is out of plane approach, and in plane you see that the local anesthetic is being injected. This is a needle, it's being injected in the posterior corner pocket so that the lower trunk gets always blocked. Complications. Apart from the usual complications of Horner syndrome, where the local anesthetic can spread from the supraclavicular area towards the intrascalene area and can still block the sympathetic chain or phrenic nerve. The other most common dreaded complication is pneumothorax. That is because of the close relation between the pleura and the subclavian artery and the rib. So when you inject the local anesthetic, we should make sure that we have to always see the rib. And if so we place the local anesthetic above the rib. If you have a discontinuity in the rib, you better not to place the local anesthetic. You just make sure that you always see the rib in continuity. Again, pre-scanning is very important because you can see variations in anatomy of the nerve or vascular structure in the field. So the next thing which we are going to see is axillary approach to brachial plexus. The anatomical point of view, what are the structures we should know is the pectoralis major muscle, the biceps muscle, the coracoid brachialis muscle, and the axillary vessels, and the conjoint tendon of latissimus dorsi and teres major. Here there is going to be a slight variation in the anatomy as well as the ultrasound image, because we are going to keep the ultrasound image in the axilla. It is going to be 90 degree clockwise, so that you can get an image in the ultrasound as a 90 degree counterclockwise. The reason is important here. We always have the median nerve, the musculocutaneous nerve, and ulnar nerve and radial nerve in this each four quadrants. It is not always stable. It's not always the same. Again, there is a huge variation in anatomy in the axillary area. So it's better to do a pre-scan, see each individual nerves before you perform the block. So again, as I told you, the area of interest is the axilla. You scan at the anterior axillary fold, and the image you're going to see is perpendicular 90 degree clockwise. And the structures which you're going to see in the ultrasound image are 90 degrees counterclockwise. When I show the image, you'll understand what I'm telling. So when is it indicated? Any procedure below the elbow, particularly in forearm and hand, the axillary approach is recommended, and anything above the elbow, the axillary approach is not so useful. Positioning and preparation. The patient is placed in supine position with an ipsilateral arm adducted 90 degrees at the shoulder. The operator sits at the head and neck of the patient, and ultrasound machine is placed directly in front, or you can do it the reverse wise also, whatever you are comfortable. Either you stand at the head end or at the foot end, and the ultrasound machine should be just opposite to you. Again, a high frequency linear transducer is used in performing the axillary block. So you see that the ultrasound is used at the anterior axillary line, and this is what the image you're going to see. So there are so many structures here. We don't know what we are seeing, but one thing is for sure, one is pulsating, that is your axillary artery. This is the first structure you should notice when you do an whenever you want to scan in the axillary area, see whether you can see the axillary artery or where is the axillary artery. The other things I'll tell you how to pick out which nerve. So first I'm going to start with the musculocutaneous nerve. You see that musculocutaneous nerve, we all know that musculocutaneous nerve lies between the two heads of coracobrachialis, right? So you see here, you see the biceps muscle, you see two coracobrachialis, and you see the aeroid area, that is the musculocutaneous nerve. The other structure we have to remember is the conjoint tendon, which is a straight line. You see that straight line here, it's a conjoint tendon of latus metatarsi anterior minor. So the structures we should remember when you do an axillary block are conjoint tendon, the muscles, the artery. So you see in between these two structures, there is a black dot which is going to travel, and that is your musculocutaneous nerve. You see here, this image not been marked, you can see it. So you see there is a structure there which is traveling from, when you scan from below towards the tip of the axilla, you see it is, you can see the structure which is going towards the artery. So that is your musculocutaneous nerve. So this is the one nerve which you have to block for when you want to block an axillary block. If you want to musculocutaneous nerve, you have to deposit the local anesthetic here. So again, this is the same thing which I described earlier. See that there is a musculocutaneous nerve, and it is always above the conjoint tendon. And as you move from apex towards from the distal to the apex, you see that the conjoint tendon is there in the apex. But as you move distally, your conjoint tendon vanishes. Again, you want me to show this picture? See that? See, this is the conjoint tendon. But when you start moving up, it is there. But when you start moving distally, it will vanish. The next structure which we have to see is the median nerve. So and from the anatomy, we know that the median nerve is between 1 and 3. Anatomically, the median nerve is between 1 and 3. But I told you in the image, it is going to be 90 degree counterclockwise. So we are going to expect a median nerve here in this area. So we already know that the musculocutaneous nerve is there between the coracobrachialis muscle. And the median nerve is going to be between, 11 o'clock to 1 o'clock position. That is the median nerve. See, the musculocutaneous nerve is down, and you forget about the musculocutaneous nerve. Just see the median nerve. So here you see that the median nerve is there. As you see that the median nerve is there at the 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock position. But how do you know that it is a median nerve? What I may say be saying may be wrong. So in order to confirm, you should start scanning from the elbow and trace the nerve towards the axilla. need to know always accompanies brachial artery, and if you trace it towards the axilla, you will know that that is the median nerve. In case when you do an axillary block and there is a median sparing, you can do this, and even you can block the nerve, median nerve alone along this pathway. So see in this image, see that's a brachial artery in the elbow, and you're going to start seeing a honeycomb structure here. So this one second, yeah, the honeycomb structure is there. If you trace it towards the axilla, it will be there always, and that is that's going to be your median nerve. So the next one is ulnar nerve. So see, we already know which is musculocutaneous nerve, which is median nerve. The next structure we should know is ulnar nerve. Here, ulnar nerve is between 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock position in the ultrasound image, but in real life it is going to be in between 3 o'clock and 6 o'clock position. So again, we are going to see the thing. So the ulnar nerve is between the axillary artery and axillary vein in this particular case. And you see that again, the ulnar nerve is between axillary artery and vein, and you see that when you press the knee, press the ultrasound probe, the vein gets compressed, but the artery is still there. How do you confirm it again? Start scanning from the median epicondyle of the humerus. You'll start seeing the ulnar nerve there. You trace it out, you'll eventually follow it up. You'll see that the nerve is still there, and it is where it is supposed to be. So that's how you confirm it is the ulnar nerve. And if your ulnar nerve is spared in your axillary block, you can trace it down anywhere along the path, and you can block individually. The next nerve which I'm going to show you is the radial nerve. Here we're going to scan from the apex to distal, and you see that the ulnar nerve is not, the radial nerve is not visible in the apex. As you move distally, you start seeing some honeycomb structure there posterior to the artery. See in this image? You can see the radial nerve posterior to the artery. So again, how do you know whether that is the radial nerve or not? Start following the nerve. So you see that there's some honeycomb structure there. We are not sure whether it is nerve or not. We just keep following that. You see that? As you keep following it up, the nerve will go, and it will go posterior to the humerus. This is where the radial nerve goes posterior to the humerus in the radial groove and comes to the lateral side. So you can trace it actually and find out that that is the radial nerve. We can say that it may be a part of branch of brachial artery, can be a profunda brachii. You do a scan, the color Doppler, to find out it is just nerve, not the vessel, and you can block the radial nerve there. So like I mentioned, we can do the block either in plane or out of plane, and this is the approach of brachial plexus, where you see the local anesthetic is being deposited. You're going to see the nerve, ultrasound, the nerve needle is going to come, and it is going to So this is out of plane approach. You see that the needle, you cannot see the needle, and the local anesthetic is being deposited. This is for the medial and radial area. Here you see the needle. It's coming there, and it is going. You're depositing the local anesthetic in the median area, median nerve. So here the local anesthetic is deposited. You can see the musculocutaneous nerve, the median nerve, the ulnar nerve, and the radial nerve. All are honeycomb structures with the local anesthetic around. Thank you. These are my references. Hello.
Over to Dr. Shekhar.
Shekhar.
Yeah, welcome to all. I don't think anybody has typed any questions. Okay, I'll give a few of the what I think easier way of approaching these brachial plexus because of my personal experience. First, in position, please do not rotate the head because it tenses the both the sternocleidomastoid and the anterior scalene muscles. So the space between the anterior scalene and the medial scalene becomes reduced. Space is reduced. When you give volume, it always seeps through anterior to the anterior scalene muscle and the phrenic nerve gets palsied. Second, do not give more than 8 to 10 ml in the interscalene groove. I always do two blocks. If it's for the shoulder, it's interscalene groove plus subclavian perivascular area block. Because one single injection in the interscalene groove, 20 ml itself will cause all the complications. So avoid volume in the interscalene groove more than 8 to 10 ml. Second is give two area of blocks. For distal also, you give subclavian perivascular and the axillary ulnar nerve supplementation so that your volume is reduced, but the block is conformationally active. Second is the needle visualization depends upon only your angle of insertion and angle of the needle to the angle of viewing of the probe. So if you maintain that, most of the time you will see the needle. I use only 23 hypodermic needle in all the blocks, including the sciatic nerve. Should be visible if you are rightly take care of that. Coming to the subclavian perivascular area block, you have to give parallel to the probe, then perpendicular to the skin, the needle is visualized well, and do not try to see the nerves in subclavian perivascular block. It looks a little funny, but you'll realize it a little later. Because only the two complications you have in a subclavian perivascular block, one is entering into the subclavian artery, second entering into the pleura. So if you keep your first rib as a safeguarding point, always visualized, and see the vessel wall clearly, so that you will not enter in both these places. The superior lateral relationship is always the nerves. So need not worry whether it is cords or even before in the division ranges. You can just inject in the superior lateral relationship. Do not go medially. If you go medially, you'll get into always into Horner syndrome. And two lateral also, you will have block failure, batches will take place. And do not minimize the volume in the subclavian perivascular area because then the C8 and T1 may not get blocked. So these are small, small clues. So volume is important in the subclavian perivascular area. Lesser volume is important in the interscalene group area. Coming to the axillary approach, you should go a little bit inferior to the artery when you are seeing in the screen because cephalot and caudal will be your probe margins. So inferior to the artery, that is caudal to the artery, you inject the drugs, and if you see the volume is a drug is depositing below the artery, then you need not change the needle at tip at all because it's going to act as a sheath phenomenon in the axilla. If you remember previously, they used to put two needles into the arterial sheath when close to the artery, dancing needles. And once negative aspiration is confirmed, they just inject volume into that because it acts as a sheath technique. So volume is important in the axilla. Please do not reduce the volume in the axilla because your chances of failure is very high. Any questions?
Thank you, sir. Right answer. Yeah, there are quite a few. Amar, wonderful lecture. Excellent. I think everybody liked your nice presentation of comprehensive anatomy, the sono positioning, sono anatomy, and then the performance itself.
First question.
Thank you, sir.
Quite a lot of questions. Dr. Veena has asked how to block suprascapular nerve.
Okay. Shall I answer, sir? Shall I answer? Hello?
Yes.
So, if you see...
Purposefully,
I didn't put a lot of things because in 25 minutes, I cannot cover the whole area. Particularly, interscalene level, we can know which nerve root we are blocking. So, suprascapular nerve originates from C5 root. And if you start tracing, it's not the basic level of ultrasound. It's a little advanced level. You start tracing only the C5 root. You'll see the suprascapular nerve starts originating from the C5 root. and you can block the suprascapular nerve at that level. Or there are approaches, you go to the posterior approach, you just above the in the suprascapular groove, you block it. So if you want to do it in only one position, you see which is the nerve, C5, C6 and C7. But how do you do that? You go to the midline, you will see the double camel hump of C6 vertebra, whereas it is single. I mean, I don't want to confuse, but you, yes, you can block suprascapular nerve alone. If you know that this is the C5 root, which is at the top, start scanning from the midline. And as you move laterally, you will see suprascapular nerve originating from C5 root and you can block that.
Dr. Dinesh has asked how to identify dorsal scapular nerve in interscalene approach.
Right. So again, the dorsal scapular nerve is also a branch of C5. So if you block C5, it will block dorsal scapular and suprascapular nerve.
That's right. And more or less you have answered that before.
Yeah.
And which one is the first nerve to block in the axillary approach?
So if you want to do it, if you don't want to do the block from in plane, obviously the intercostal, the muscular cutaneous nerve is the first nerve to come. Again, it's an individual preference. So if you are very close to the nerve, just better give the local there and then go proximally and block the median nerve. And again, you see, there is no one way of doing things. Like Dr. Sekar said, you can even put two needles into the, just feel for the artery, put needle one above and one below, it block works. But because of the ultrasound, we are able to see if the each and individual nerves we can block. You can block any whatever nerve you are comfortable with. Either in plane or out of plane, there is, see, a lot of things I prefer doing out of plane, most of the people, but the classical teaching is when the nerve is superficial, like your upper limb blocks, the recommendation is you do an in plane block. But how expertise you are, whether you are sure that your needle is there, there are whatever you are comfortable, you can block whatever needle, whatever nerve you want.
I think that will probably answer the question. Dr. Joyce Nelma James has asked, what drug additives and what volume would you recommend?
Right, Dr. Sekar has already, Dr. Sekar has already mentioned, intrascalene, you don't use larger volume. And when you move towards the axillary or supraclavicular, you have to use a larger volume. But there are papers saying that 3 ml is enough, 5 ml is enough. But they are all more of a theoretical concern. If you want to avoid phrenic nerve block, yes, you have to reduce your volume. But if you start going in the anti, even in the scaling, there are three approaches. Upper interscaling approach, middle interscaling approach, lower interscaling approach. As you go a little lower in the interscalene, as the roots joins to trunk, where you put the local anesthetic near the trunk, the local anesthetic can be reduced. But I suggest you use minimum 30 ml in the supraclavicular or axillary, minimum 30 ml. And interscalene, you say, like as I said, reduce the volume. You can see the nerve, place 3 ml this side, 2 ml that side, 5 ml to 6 to 8 ml should be fine. But
so listen.
Yes, tell me, sir.
I'll add a little bit here.
Yes, you want your opinion.
Two things are there. Either it is an analgesic block or a surgical block. Because there is a world of difference between the dorsal scapular nerve alone is blocked being analgesic, but dorsal scapular nerve is blocked for the sake of shoulder surgery. There are two things. One, we use volume more when you use the surgical plane and two places. That's number one. Number two is when you use area is very important. Subplane perivascular, it's a very compact area. Lesser volume is enough. Whereas in the axilla, the areolar tissue is quite high. The dissipation of the drug goes into much away from the nerves. So that the volume is very, very important. The theoretical saying is nerve block for 3 ml is really true when the nerve, when the drug stays along the nerve. But the moment you give it off, it will dissipate. Then your block may not be sufficient. So please include volume into that areas. Because what are you going to gain by reducing to 3 ml, 5 ml and all? Better to give 8 ml to 10 ml in that area for a median nerve. I'll give at least 8 ml for a median nerve, separately ulnar nerve under this. So at least 20 ml in the axillary area.
That's wonderful information for the beginners and learners, I think so, sir. And another part of the question was additives. I think Decadron is very popular.
Yeah.
I think most places, they stick to that drug now.
All the trying to right, but
what is your additive of choice? And Dr. Amar also, Dr. Shekhar and Amar. Additive.
I personally don't use any additives, but the recommendations are the three drugs which has been recommended by meta-analysis, which is useful, are dexamethasone, clonidine or dexmedetomidine, and the third one is buprenorphine. These are three ONOs which has been recommended or by shown in meta-analysis to be prolonging the nerve blocks. But personally, I don't add any additives in my nerve blocks.
Shekhar, sir.
If we consider clonidine, we had once the block clonidine, and then we had a phrenic nerve palsy. It takes a very long time to recover. So I usually use only dexamethasone, relatively safe. It considerably prolongs the duration of analgesia.
Sir, Kannan sir has asked experience regarding catheter technique for post-operative analgesia more than 24 hours.
We have continuous catheters available, contiplex. We have the 55 millimeter and 110 millimeters. For all the upper limb nerve blocks, we can use the 55 millimeter stimulating. Even though you use ultrasound, we can use stimulating nerve stimulation to confirm the position, and we can place it in intrascalene as well as supraclavicular or axillary area. And if you don't have them, we can still use the 18 gauge 2-he needle and place the epidural catheter. Place the 2-he needle 18 gauge. Inject some local anesthetic and pass the epidural catheter, and still we can use it for more than 24 hours.
Yeah, one last question, Sir Kanna. I guess, sir, listen, your comments.
Sorry to interfere.
No, your comments, please.
I strongly do not advocate catheters in the upper limb blocks. I don't know how many of you noticed. There are two reasons for that. One, if you see the core fibers and the mandible fibers in the upper limb motor blockade takes over the first, sensory comes last. They say the patient will not move the limb, but he says pain when you touch after the block by about 5 minutes time. Whereas in the lower limb, sensory goes first and motor goes later. So if you do use a lesser concentration in the catheters, you will lose only the motor and pain will persist. That's number one, why I don't use catheters in the upper limb. Second, after the ultrasound, you can repeat it any number of times, because nerve stimulation you cannot use when the drug is there, whereas ultrasound doesn't bother about it. So you can repeat any time of that, any volume also calculated. So ultrasound wise, I don't need a catheter at all. So I can repeat, already takes about 10 to 12 hours minimum action and goes for up to 24 hours. So repeat after 12 hours or 24 hours.
Yeah, the problem is after sending the patient to the ward to do it.
Or what we can do is, like Sir said, we can repeat it. But still, if you want a catheter, we don't use continuous infusion for intrascalene. Leave the catheter, come back after 12 hours or 24 hours, whatever the duration, and inject a higher concentration, 0.25% or 0.375% bupivacaine. If you don't want to bring the patient back and do the block again, you can do that.
Yeah, I think we are nearing the closing time of this session, 11:55. So one last question to conclude. Are you still using mixture of local anesthetics to obtain the benefit of early onset and longer action of another? Is it still valid, or what's your experience, both of you?
It depends upon how early you want to start the surgery. The surgeon is already ready and he wants to go somewhere, or you are ready, we want to go earlier, you mix the local anesthetic. Otherwise, for analgesic, I don't mix local anesthetic, just give 0.25 or 0.375% bupivacaine for analgesic. But for surgery, if you want it to act, patient is in pain, you want to give quick pain relief, I personally mix, but there are people in our center, they don't mix and they claim it acts faster, because you're going to give the, under ultrasound, you're going to give closer to the nerve. Sometimes they even inject intraneurally, not intraneurally, within the sheath, so that the drug acts faster. Sir, your comments.
I do use drugs even now, along with dexamethasone. I'll have a different explanation for this mixing business. Lignocaine, if you remember, in the sodium channels, acts in the middle of the tract. I don't know whether I am conveying the message. Whereas bupivacaine is acting at the inner portion of the sodium channel. If you see that mechanism of action of the drugs. So the channels which are actually stimulated gets blocked first and faster. So usually when you give a block, the channels which open, lignocaine goes and immediately act. Whereas bupivacaine traverses through the lipophilic, traverses through the membrane, goes inside and acts. So it takes longer time, but it stabilizes well with bupivacaine. So if you do a mixture, by 3 to 5 minutes time, my block is always complete, ready for the surgery immediately. And it gets prolonged also, and dexamethasone maybe stabilizes the membrane action so that the block acts for 18 to 24 hours now.
So I think with that comments from Dr. Shaker, any closing remarks for this session, sir?
One, sorry. Somebody has asked about short bevel needles available.
Yeah. Availability, it is available. No,
so the hypodermic needle only you will use. That's all. Yeah. I don't know.
I didn't pursue that question because it is all.
No,
any closing remarks, sir? Thank you, Amar.
Wonderful. Thank you, sir.
Presentation. I think it was very useful. Now, purposefully wanted a video demonstration this time. It has never been attempted because of the technical reasons. We had a lot of concerns whether it would play or not. But then you did it well and presented well. Thank you so much. Shaker sir, thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Edward sir, we'll go to
the next session.
Yeah.
For the next section, that is the panel discussion and the medical legal experts, I invite Dr. Chairan and Dr. S. N. Krishnamurthy as the moderator, as the chairpersons, and I invite Sudarshan as the moderator of the session. Over to you, Sudarshan.
Thank you, Dr. Edward. So, hello again. I think we have beautiful experts today, excellent people who are top in their specialty, both Dr. Chairan. I think an introduction for Dr. Chairan was already given by our Dr. Edward in the beginning. Dr. Chairan, he joined a little late. For the benefit of people who also joined late, Dr. Chairan is basically a person who practices medical law as a full-time as of today. He is a qualified medical personnel, did his MBBS from Madras Medical College, DCH from Madras Medical College, and MS Ophthalmology. He's an ophthalmology professor. He did his MS Ophthalmology from Stanley Medical College, and BL from Madras Law College. So all these credentials and many more qualifications he has had, diploma, many diplomas by Indira Gandhi National University is obtained. And he is currently Professor Head of the Department of Ophthalmology, Government Vellore Medical College, formerly also. And now he's a doctor, full-time turned into an advocate, who been helping most of medical professionals all over the state and everywhere, who look for him for his advice, number one, for taking up their medical cases to defend the doctors, and that is Yeoman Service. He's been doing it for quite some time. He's also an advisor for IMA and the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, all other specialty associations. Welcome, Dr. Chairan, for the session. And I have Dr. Krishnamurthy once again, a brief introduction. He's the professor at our department, Sathya Sai Medical College Hospital in Chengalpet. And he's basically, we all know that he's an anesthesiologist. He's a professor in another department, retired from Madurai Medical College. A lot of his students are here today. And he has also had a Bachelor of Law qualified, and he is also MBA qualified. And any of his medical legal opinion from the anesthetic colleagues, we look forward to Dr. SNK, sir. So with that brief introduction, we will start the session for the day. And to begin with, two questions each for the experts. Number one question will be addressed to Dr. Chairan. How often do the anesthetists get litigation suit against them directly? And what's the commonest reason for an anesthesia medico-legal suit against anesthetists, if you have come across many more cases like that? What's the commonest cause, sir?
Good morning, friends. You have read correctly whatever I have written and given to them to talk about me. In addition, they mentioned I'm a full-time advocate. Yes. Why I wanted them to mention that? Because whatever I'm going to talk is of practical importance. Whatever I'm going to talk is about real lifetime scenarios. I'm attending the court every day and out. So whatever is happening in the courts, what are the assumptions and presumptions of the judicial officers? I'm going to bring it out through your questions and answers. So first question, how often the anesthetist is directly litigated or involved? Fortunately for anesthetists, I have to say not very often. The cases are normally filed against the hospital and mostly against the surgeons. If at all the case is filed against an anesthetist, it is in addition to hospital and surgeon. Very rarely the cases are filed against only against the anesthetist. I think I have answered your first part.
Yes, yes sir. If so, what is the commonest reason for an anesthetist to get into litigation? So,
mainly death on the table.
So other minor...
Other complications arising out of surgery, arising out of anesthesia is secondary. Main right. is only about the death on the table.
Has there been any major settlements over the past several years for litigation against anesthesiologists? What is the maximum amount settled so far? Because people having fear that they can be sued even district court to up to a tune of crore. Anybody practicing, they take indemnity. Now, minimum indemnity taken up is 1 crore by most of the anesthesiologists in practicing in the cities. So rural area also, the courts have the right to give a compensation up to 1 crore. So that is the fear. So what is the maximum settlement and what are all the worries anesthetists to have in terms of settlement, sir?
Okay, two things I would like to make it clear. One, the settlement in legal term, it is something different, not as you view. What do you mean or what do you view, I think, is compensation.
Compensation.
Settlement is always out of court settlement.
Yes, yes.
The court does not ask you to settle things. The court asks you to compensate. They award compensation and you have to pay. So, and unfortunately, there is no single platform over which we can have the statistics of how much is awarded in each court. So I'm afraid I may not be able to tell you the correct answer for what is the maximum amount of compensation awarded for against the anesthetist. That is one thing. But from the date 2013, Dr. Kunal Saha case, a very landmark judgment, the compensation awarded against the doctors have increased manifold. Earlier it was 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs. Now it is very easily 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs. So why I am telling this? Because you have to take insurance to cover that sort of amount. So the compensation awarded is in running 2 lakhs, easily 30 lakhs, 40 lakhs. So that is the message I wanted to give. And you were talking about the rural district forums and other things. The rural district forum, what is known as pecuniary jurisdiction. What is pecuniary jurisdiction means, if you are going to claim up to 1 crore, you can file your complaint, you can file your case in district forum. District forum is district headquarters in every state. But that does not mean that the award should also be up to 1 crore. Up to 1 crore, the complaint, the claim can be filed. That is also as per the recent Consumer Protection Act 2019, it is not the compensation you demand is deciding the fora. Earlier, if you want this much of compensation, it has to be filed in this court like that. Up to 10 lakhs, one court, up to 20 lakhs, another court like that. Now, it is not the compensation you ask for decide the forum, it is the receipt or it is the amount you have paid as per service is the amount which decides the forum. So if you have to file a case in the district consumer forum, the amount you have paid for the medical services should be up to 1 crore. I don't think any hospital or any doctor charges 1 crore for any case. So almost all the cases filed against the doctors hereafter will be only in consumer districts. It will not go to states. It will not go to national commission. I think I am clear.
Yes,
if you paid 1 crore, up to 1 crore, you can file the case in district consumer forum. Not the amount of compensation you want, amount you have paid as fees.
Yes, that is why there was a confusion there. That is why we wanted more clarity. Because people think they can file up to 1 crore means they are worried.
Earlier it was compensation depending upon the compensation demanded. Now it is depending upon the fees you have paid.
Fees, they are paid in the hospital as a whole.
Yes, as a whole.
Entire hospital stay during the hospital. That is good information, sir. So the district itself can accept up to 1 crore is something also is a cost to. So any most cases will come to the district itself. Is that correct, sir? So they need not go
almost
to
that. Almost all.
Yes, that is fine, sir. So the next beginning question to Dr. Krishnamurthy, sir, if you were to name 2 factors medically to be followed by anesthesiologists during their practice to prevent or save them from landing in a litigation suit, 2 points to prevent.
Yes. Yes.
Would you be able to suggest?
Thank you, sir, for asking me to participate in this discussion. I am emboldened by the fact that Dr. Chairman is there to edit my version if at all I make any mistakes. He's a PACA lawyer.
Thank you.
I am a half-baked or pseudo lawyer because I have no courtroom experience, but I have knowledge of law because I am interested in it. Now, the 2 factors that can make or mar the career of an anesthetist is, first one, the presence or absence of an anesthesia record, which is accurate, complete, and preferably contemporaneous. Poor record means poor defense, no record means no defense. It happens very often in small private nursing homes run by a single surgeon or an obstetrician. The anesthetist goes there, does his work, collects the money, and just goes away. There is no record of any kind there. So when such cases land in the court, you are in a very difficult situation. And when some litigation arises, then a case sheet is hastily prepared, which can be easily seen through as a manufactured record, because such records seem to have a mosaic pattern, the same handwriting from the beginning to the end. Whereas an actual contemporaneously made record will have a kaleidoscopic pattern, different handwritings, different color inks, pens, and all that. So that can be easily seen through. So that is one thing, the presence or absence of a record helps the anesthetist to escape from the litigation. And the another one is a reasonable degree of care in the anesthetic management of the patient. If the doctor does not stay with the patient throughout till the end of the case, till he recovers or succumbs to any complication, many of the private practitioners have the habit of leaving the case when the abdominal closure begins. They hand over the charge to one of their PGs or to some junior theater assistant and go for the next case. Similarly, whenever a complication happens, they intubate the patient, start ventilation, and hand over the ventilation to somebody in the clinic, and then they just go away. You have to be present throughout the case. If any complication happens, you have to be present throughout the end of that complication. You have to accompany the patient during the transport to a higher center, where you will hand over the patient to an equally competent person, telling him what happened during the procedure and what has been done so far for that patient. And even after admitting him in the higher center, you have to keep in touch with the patient periodically, participate in the management up to the extent that second hospital allows you. And till the patient either recovers or succumbs, you have to be with him. So that is the reasonable degree of care. When we don't do that, we are in for a litigation.
That is fine, sir. I think most people would have got the message of the...
Tell two things. One is documentation, another one is consent or communication. Yes, consent is also important from anesthesia point of view. You have to get consent, specific consent to the anesthesia. So documentation, communication, or consent.
That is what I'm coming to. Is it absolutely necessary to get a separate consent for anesthesia, other than, because earlier days when we started to practice 20, 25 years ago, it was only a common consent. And that one word of patient will, required anesthesia can be administered as per the required specification. That one word would have been there. But now, after this NABH and other systems of auditing, of internally monitoring the service of standards, many of these hospitals have started designing their own anesthesia consent, but not every hospital. So is it absolutely essential to have a separate anesthesia consent, sir?
Yes, sir. A separate consent for anesthesia is certainly desirable. And as you said, all the regulatory bodies like NABH are insisting on a separate consent for anesthesia, both in the English as well as in the local vernacular language of the patient. But if the patient has any anesthesia concerns, like a difficult airway or some other problem which impinges directly on the anesthetic management, then in those cases, it is absolutely essential that we get a separate consent for anesthesia, outlining the particular complications or difficulties experienced in our anesthetic management. In a ASA 1 case, normal healthy patient without any comorbidities, the current practice is still a composite consent that is included along with the surgery. That may be acceptable, but when there are difficult anesthesia problems exclusive to the anesthetics, difficult airway is one example, and similarly some skeletal abnormalities which make original anesthesia techniques difficult, all these things must go for a separate consent for anesthesia, wherein we should mention the particular risk involved in that particular anesthetic management of that particular patient. So even in otherwise, a separate consent form is certainly desirable.
Karen, sir, what is your...
Earlier, as he said, there was only one consent when I passed out MBBS way back in 1979. Now the concept of informed consent has been introduced. This is the term coined by Supreme Court of India, informed consent. So whenever you talk about informed consent, you have to tell about the anesthesia, you have to tell about the surgery, you have to tell about various other things which are covered by consent, then you have to get the signature. So when you are talking about informed consent, I think you have to get individual consents for anesthesia as well as consent.
Right, sir. That,
because an informed consent over surgery may not be an informed consent over anesthesia.
Thank you, sir. So next we will go on to some questions by our other members of our ISA Coimbatore branch. I'm just sharing, I've just asked all of them to send their queries as a video. So I'll be playing one after the other. And the experts you already introduced, the question implicit are number one, Dr. Yagambarakrishnan, who is my close colleague for close to 20 years. He's a freelance consultant. So what we have done today is I've chosen four anesthesia consultants from different background. One as a freelancer, what are all his concerns for freelance practice? The other person from corporate hospital and their concerns in corporate practice. Other person is from a medical college, government hospital background. And most importantly, the fourth person, both freelancer and a hospital owner. So we have these four different anesthesiologists from different backgrounds and their worries about their anesthetic practice. So I will start, yeah.
Audio.
Listen, audio is not. Audio not seen?
Yes.
Yeah, I will reshare it just a minute. When I share sound, I have not mentioned. I will do that. Yes. A minute, I'll come back. Yeah.
Is there any time frame? Second question to.
Sorry. I will go back to the.
Good morning, friends.
Yeah.
I am Dr. Yagambarakrishnan, freelancing anesthesiologist.
Are you okay?
Oh, okay. My first question to Dr. Charan, please. And the question is there any time frame is recommended legally to take a written informed anesthesia consent before any anesthetic procedure or a surgical procedure? My main question is when to take informed written consent just before the surgery is enough, or you need any time frame?
So
it's possible to have the question on the screen. Is it possible? Yeah.
No, sir. I will tell you what he mentioned.
Because sometimes the audio goes off.
No. He wants to know what's the time duration from the time of seeing the patient and taking the consent to take up for surgery. Is it many times freelance anesthesiologist, they just
ask
the patient and take up the patient?
So again, this corresponds to informed consent. What is meant by informed consent means the patient, before giving his consent, should understand what is going to happen to him, understand the ideologies and the methodologies of the surgery, anesthesia, and what is going to be the benefit for him, then give his consent. This is known as informed consent. The informed consent also covers up certain time to be given to him to make an informed decision. So the time scenario in this happens to give optimum time for him to make an informed decision. And the time should also cover time to revise his decision if he is going to make such one. So ideally, law does not describe any fixed time, like 1 week or 10 days or like that. All it says is he should be given time to make an informed decision. He should be given time to revise his decision. But practically, 1 or 2 days prior to the procedure, the consent should be obtained. Right. 1 or 2 days, minimum, right. Minimum.
Practically, it's not...
Not in emergency.
Many occasions,
in a planned procedure, this is the ideal time. In an emergency, there is no necessity to get the consent earlier. You need not even get consent.
But 1 to 2 days is too long a time, because many times these patients get admitted previous night, come for surgery the next day morning. We see the patient the previous night if we are lucky, but we try to explain everything.
Yes, this is that trap laid for anesthetists. Yes, I am repeating. If you don't follow this, and if the opposite advocate is able to raise this issue in the court of law, you are in trouble.
Okay. Because many daycare surgeries,
everywhere, I know that it is not being followed. It is not practical also. It is not being followed. I know that the anesthetist meet the patient for the first time in the theater, or sometimes the surgeon meets the patient for the first time in the theater. The hospital would have reviewed the patient. Hospital would have called the visiting surgeon, visiting anesthetist. They would have come and met the patient for the first time in the theater. But legally, it is not allowed.
Okay, so I think better be careful. People should clearly mention what are all the consent time also. That is very important. So thank you, sir, for that answer. So we go to the next question on our this thing. Next question again from Dr. Yagamaram.
Good morning, friends. I am Dr. Yagamaram Krishnan, freelancing anesthetist. My second question to Dr. The question is, when we start the anesthesia, some mishaps happen during the induction or the end of the anesthetic procedure. Whether the anesthetist alone is solely responsible for the mishaps, or the consultant surgeon or the hospital is also responsible in a case of legal compensation matters.
Sir, he's asking the question is, when an anesthesia related mishap happens, say it can be during the induction starting of the procedure or towards the end, technically it is purely anesthesia related problem. Say baby patient, he could not intubate and there was a problem and patient became hypoxic and then mishap happens. Or it can be any perioperative cardiac event, fibrillations and all those things. He is asking, is any anesthesia particularly related diagnosis as the cause of death? Is only anesthetist held responsible or the entire team, he's asking.
I already told you most of the time anesthetists are not implicated as a party. More often hospital, very often surgeons. Anesthetists are not implicated as parties. Suppose anesthetists are not implicated as parties till the end of the case, and if it is found to be an anesthetic complication, an anesthetic negligence, hospital will be awarded compensation to pay against. Suppose there are certain cases where hospital as well as surgeons are also made to pay, even though as a medico-legal person, I know that it is not proper to ask the surgeon to pay when it is not his negligence or fault. But it sometimes it happens because one doctor, one hospital. That is what the court takes into account. And when the anesthetist is not in picture, but if it is purely an anesthetic negligence, sometimes it happens, surgeon is awarded against. But more often, it is hospital which is awarded against. But if it is, the anesthetist is implicated, then it is purely the compensation will go against the anesthetist and the hospital, not against the surgeon.
Yeah, so but the hospital is, we have provided all the infrastructure, all the facilities. What can we do if the by the doctor happens? What should has it happened or really? Any such occurrences have happened, sir? Hospital, we have provided every infrastructure. It is only the individual consultants.
It stems out from the decision made in Supreme Court in Savita Garg. There was one case known as Savita Garg case, where the Supreme Court held that the hospital is responsible on two accounts. One, the patient comes to the hospital. It is an institution where the patient gets admitted. More often, the hospital only chooses the anesthetist, not the patient. Patient does not choose anesthetist. Hospital chooses the anesthetist. So if something goes wrong with the anesthetist, hospital is held responsible. That is one thing. Second thing, the Savita Garg judgment has categorically ruled out that even if the doctor name is added as a party or not, the hospital name is added, that is enough. Because hospital is an institution, it has got much more responsibility than individual doctor. Today, the doctor will be there in the hospital. Tomorrow, he may go to some other hospital. But hospital is a fixed entity. Of course, it can be closed, no doubt about that. Then there is no question at all. So there is a fixed entity. The law always fixes upon the responsibility on a fixed entity. So hospital is a more responsible person. Hospital only ropes in anesthetist. So hospital to the hospital only, the patient comes in. So for all these things, the Supreme Court has fixed upon the responsibility on the hospital rather than on the doctors.
Thank you, sir. That is very clear, absolutely crystal clear on that. So I will go to the next question to Dr. SNK by Dr. Yagamaram quickly. Yeah.
My question to Dr. Krishnamurthy, sir. Sir, there are a large group of drugs which are not officially allowed to use either in epidural or spinal space. And the very common example is your epidural Depometrol. Even in the prescription, it has mentioned it is not to be used epidurally. But our routine practice, we are forced to use this epidural Depometrol to many of our orthopedic procedure. If any disturbance or any difficulty happens, are we legally bound for our negligence?
Yes, certainly. See, the literature very clearly states that a particular drug is not suitable for this kind of administration. It is given in the pamphlet accompanying the vial. Take for example, dexmedetomidine. It is not advocated for spinal use, intrathecal use, but still some people are doing as part of their studies, PGs. They give a small dose of dexmedetomidine intraspinally and say that they say it is very good. My own PGs have done it. But when there is a problem, this will not stand in a court of law. I hope my Dr. Charan will agree with this point. See, the literature very clearly states that as of now, this drug is not approved for this route of administration. And then knowing fully well that it is not approved, you are going ahead with the use. That is contradicting the law. So it will not be acceptable and he will be held liable for any complications that may occur directly as a result of that drug. The patient has to prove that this particular complication occurred directly because of this particular drug administration, this route of administration, and only because of that the adverse outcome has happened. So it's a very difficult task for the patient, but morally you are responsible.
Chairman sir, what's your opinion on that?
Yes, yes,
yes.
I mean, very categorically, he has explained the law.
Yes, sir. Yes, okay. Thank you. So, quickly, we'll go to the next part of the presentation. I think, please mute. Shilpa, child background. Yeah. Next will be Dr. Subbaiya. He works in. Coimbatore, he is a very well known person in terms of his lecturing abilities and ability to question others. So I invite him to shoot his first question.
Good morning to one and all. Thanks to ISA for giving this opportunity to ask questions on medical legal aspects of anesthesia. My first question is to Dr. Krishnamurthy. Sir, even in corporate setup, we do have certain patients with suspected cardiac disease who are not actually having a complete cardiac evaluation for reasons like unaffordability. Some of these patients may be on the CMKT scheme or genuinely unaffordable. Should some cardiac event take place in the cardiac in the perioperative period, how liable are anesthetists working in corporate setup? When the patients are not fully evaluated?
We will be fully liable, 100% liable, because knowing fully well there is a cardiac problem and that it has not been assessed properly, you are going ahead with the case and the complication, the very complication that we expect happens. So that answers the but-for test. But for this procedure, I mean, but for this negligence, the complication would not have happened. See, if the patient is not able to afford, then it is our duty to send him to a place where he can be done it freely. Send him to a government setup for evaluation. And then he can come back to his favorite hospital, favorite surgeon, favorite anesthetist, and get the surgery done. But in an emergency, this may be acceptable. When there is pressure for time, like say, for example, fetal distress or internal hemorrhage, this may be acceptable. We can just tell the patient, look here, you have got a problem, but we will take care. There is no time for evaluation and all those things. And you get a proper informed consent. Then you can proceed. But in an elective situation where there is a lot of time, there is no pressure, time pressure at all, we have no justification to compromise on this anesthetic, this part of the anesthetic management. So the anesthetist who proceeds knowing fully well there is a cardiac problem, the extent or the magnitude of which he does not know anything because it has not been evaluated properly, he goes ahead with the management of the case, gets into that complication, he will have to answer for it.
Yes, Dr. SMK has told one part of the story is if the patient is unaffordable, you can refer him to some other institution. That is one part of the story. Second part of the story, as a doctor, we are primarily and totally concerned with patient welfare. So if there is going to be unaffordability, I mark my words, if there is going to be unaffordability, still, you cannot refer him to higher centers quoting unaffordability because it is your duty and responsibility, moral responsibility to treat the patient even if he is unaffordable, to do whatever is necessary for his well-being. So you cannot refer the patient saying that he cannot afford. Still, you have to do whatever is necessary and take care of him in your own hospital. So deviating from the protocol, quoting unaffordability never arises, never exists in law.
So we can't claim to be innocent that because the patient is not affordable. If he can, as you say, if he can afford a surgery, he should be able to afford additional consultation also. His safety, is that right, sir?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. So the next question from Dr. Subbaiah, I think I will go to that. Subbaiah, I think the first question has been answered to your satisfaction, I hope.
Yes, of course. I'm listening. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. The next question.
Only listening. Not convinced. Yeah.
But there's a difference between practicality and the law, of course. Sir?
Yes, sir. You sometimes take a calculated risk. It's a game. Yes, sometimes you win, sometimes you fail. All in the interest of the patient.
When you,
absolutely.
Personally, I'll be able to give you a clue to that. I'll be able to give you an idea to pass over this.
Please do, sir. Please do. Please give us a clue.
In the forum. Okay, let's go on.
Okay, sir. Okay. The next question from Dr. Subbaiah, I will display it.
Good morning to one and all. Thanks to ISA for giving this opportunity to ask questions. My second question to Dr. Krishnamurthy. Sir, in corporate setup, we do undertake very complex procedures which can take several hours, 9 hours, 16 hours. In certain circumstances, we do have one anesthetist taking over, starting a case, and then someone else actually taking over after 8 hours. Should there be a critical incident which lead to a medical legal problem, are both anesthetists liable, or do we have to actually find out exactly when that event happened and only that person will be liable?
Yes, sir. It's a very interesting problem. Handing over and taking over, as you said, takes place routinely in all government hospitals and the corporate hospitals, where the first anesthetist hands over the case to the second anesthetist, who is equally competent and qualified. But when you are taking a long surgery, when you are giving anesthesia for a long surgery, you have to leave halfway through the surgery. At the time of leaving, if you have made a record of the patient's condition, the intraoperative record speaks. If you have made a record, and the second anesthetist also makes a concurring statement, and that is part of the anesthesia record, then the first anesthetist will escape. Because after all, up to his working hours, the patient was in a stable and safe condition. The incident or whatever occurred in the later part of the anesthetic management. And so probably the second anesthetist will have to face the music, how it happened and all that. But the first anesthetist will escape, provided there are records to show that at the time of his leaving the case or handing over the case, everything was okay.
Again, I'm going to deviate from the routine. Government hospitals, everyone know that. There will be duty hours, and after duty hours, the case will be handed over to the next person. But before dealing with the government hospital, I'll deal with the private hospital. Private hospital, whether it is corporate or a small or medium hospital, when you get the consent, anesthetist name has to be written in the consent form. So now I am going to talk as an advocate, not as a medical legal person or a doctor. Once I give consent for a particular person to give anesthesia to me in a private hospital, there is no question of somebody handing over the case to some other person. Even some hospitals manage it like as a team. They will put Dr. X on team. Even then, there was a case in government hospital I dealt with regarding Tanjavur Medical College, where the court found out that if there is going to be a problem, if there is going to be an issue, there is going to be some difficulty, then forget about your duty hours. You have to stay on and deal with the case. Then once the case is stabilized, then only you can leave the theater. This is what the court interpreted. Even though the duty hours have been over, it is emergency, it is medical science, you cannot just leave the hall once your duty time is over. You can do that provided nothing is wrong. But if the things are in trouble, if there is some problem, then you cannot leave it. You should be present in the theater. This is with regard to government hospital. Then you know what will be the interpretation for private and corporate hospitals.
So no point.
Leaving the ball to the other person does not arise if there is going to be a problem. If there is no problem, then it was very well handed over. If the problem arose with the second person, there is no issue at all. Second person is held responsible.
So that is, I think, very clear. Subhaya, I think you can safely hand it over to equally qualified. There is another clause also to be handed over to an equally qualified.
That is what I meant by team. Your team member should be equally competent.
That is very important.
Yes, competent or qualified.
Member who is inferior qualified in your team.
Yes. Does seniority anywhere play a role here, sir?
No, absolutely not.
Can hand over to somebody?
Absolutely not. Fresher, senior, probably if the difficulty is of higher order, they might expect an expert opinion or a specialist hand to solve the issue. That's the second person. They will not question the first person. You are an inexperienced or junior person.
Okay.
And understand, you can always ask for a help if he is in trouble.
Right.
Not that somebody.
Go on to the part of.
Not that somebody else is going to do something better.
Yeah.
Court appreciates if there are two persons.
Yeah.
Can take care or handle the issue better.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Thank you. So next question, I will go with
my third question to Dr. Charan. Sir, sometimes we have a situation where one of the anesthetic monitoring system is not working or is faulty. It might be in the middle of a list, for example, an entitled CO2 monitor is not working. But if the hospital management says that they do not have enough time to actually fix it or have spares, and the anesthetist proceeds on with the case, and should there be an event, who is liable? Is it the hospital or the anesthetist? Thank you.
Dr. Sudarshan, can you repeat it again?
Yeah, so he's asking, sir, suppose if any critical monitor which requires to be present during the time of surgery and it fails when the surgery starts, or it was not available also, but the hospital says, okay, you go ahead, it should be acceptable, something like a vital monitor like entitled carbon dioxide for a surgery. So if it fails, and should there be any problem because of absence of that monitor, who is liable? Is it the anesthetist or the hospital which has instructed the anesthetist to go ahead?
Definitely, anesthetist will not be spared. Anesthetist is always held liable. Of course, in addition, hospital will also be held liable.
So the primary
doubt about that.
Responsibility without a monitor, technical person has to refuse.
Monitor.
To
all infrastructure should be in place. Yeah. One first point. Second point, it should be in working order, well calibrated. Third point. So infrastructure should be there. It should be in working order. Two, third thing, it should have been recently calibrated. All these three things are must before an anesthetist steps into action.
Right, sir. So I think Subhaya, that will complete your portion of the questioning. I think I'll go on to the next person, Dr. Sithil Nathan, who is a professor in government Coimbatore Medical College. He was been very keen in education and imparting knowledge.
Good morning, everybody.
To Sithil.
Good morning, sir. I am Dr. Sandhil Nathan, senior assistant anesthesiology, Coimbatore Medical College. My first question is
video.
Usually in medical course, to take even ASA4 cases, very severe cases for surgical exercise. And they say that they have a consent, they have received a consent from the attenders that it's an on-table death consent. And usually this consent is received late, and probably the patient succumbs to any morbidity or mortality during the surgery. And so if I really want to know whether there really exists a consent called as on the table death consent, and if so, if something
is
happens,
is there an on table death consent? That's a patient, moribund patient, very sick patient, are being taken up in many of these medical institutions as a referred case. So that's what he wants to know, sir. Is there a consent called on table death consent or any?
I told you for elective procedures, 1 or 2 days gap is necessary to get the consent. For emergency, there is no such rule. I even told you, in an emergency, dire emergency to save the life, you can do any procedure without even a consent. So there is a, not only the consent on the table, you can do the procedure even without a consent, if the emergency situation demands.
So we should establish that there is an emergency.
It's an emergency. It is your responsibility. When the court case comes to the court, it is your primary responsibility to establish that that was an emergency to save the life of a patient. Then you can do without consent.
But many a time, sir, there is a faint line between urgent surgery and emergent, because what happens is something like a perforation, abdomen, intestinal perforation.
That is why I said, I am very clear. That is why I said, the Supreme Court has categorized only one thing, emergency to save life. All the other things does not fall in place. Emergency to save complication, emergency to save limb. No. Emergency to save life is only emergency legally. All the other things are medical emergencies.
Legally.
Legal emergency is only one. Emergency.
Okay, that is very
life.
Clear.
The solution, sir, shall I intervene a little?
Yeah.
Chairman sir, can you hear me?
Yes.
See, this on the table death consent is actually received by the surgeons alone. The surgeons who take care of the patients, they receive this consent called as on the table death consent. This is not, as you told it, it's not an informed consent like anesthetist talking to the patient. Anesthetic talking to the patient's attenders. It is the surgeons alone who get the on-the-table death consent, because they want to do a surgical exercise. They just want to operate whether the patient is going to come out successfully after the surgery or not. They are least worried about that, but they want to operate. In that scenario, if the patient's attender goes for a litigation, then will the anesthetist also be held responsible for that? This is the question I want to ask.
I'm sorry, I'm not able to understand what is on the table death consent. What is that?
That is a consent award. All government.
There cannot be any consent for death. Nobody will give you consent for death.
That's what we want to know.
You won't give. Cannot get. Obviously, you cannot get. There should be some other terminology.
But they are telling like that.
Many of these.
No court will
many
allow.
Many of these hospitals, they.
Sir, may I say something, sir? When I was working in Velamal Hospital,
yes, sir.
See, some patients are referred from critical care unit for a late surgery. And they are in an extremely morbid condition, pulse, yes, BP, Curry, and sepsis. And they have a lot of core morbidities, venipuncture marks everywhere, or a CP line running. They are on 2 or more vasopressors. Actually, their condition is very bad, but still surgeons want to do some surgery. And I've actually seen such consent forms that the word death is mentioned in the consent form. Any complications, including death, something like that figures in that consent form. I have seen that, but I am not for it. We can only say mention the complications. No, death, of course.
Coin as some other term.
Yes, sir, than correct. That, exactly. Sir, that's what I was
coming to. Accepting death.
Death,
if
yes, sir.
To die, why should I submit to you, myself to you?
No, the patient is already half dead, sir, in the critical unit.
No, I understand. As a doctor, I understand,
yes,
what
sir.
You say.
Yes, sir.
I understand.
Yes,
sir. There is every chance of death happening on the table.
Yes.
I want to emphasize upon the patient. But the terminology cannot be consent to death.
What will be the terminology then, sir?
No.
What
no.
could be the terminology?
Depending upon the condition. Suppose you say you are your condition is moribund, you can say that understanding the condition as moribund, like that.
Yes, sir. It must be couched in some general
terms. But a patient in moribund condition will not be fit enough to give a consent in the first place.
No, sir. Relatives.
If it's an ASFI patient, is already comatose.
Yes.
For emergencies, there is no rule. That is why I said.
No, it is the relatives, sir.
Give consent.
Correct,
even
sir.
Without consent, you can do.
No, sir. NABH says that in the consent,
it shouldn't be given
you have
a consent.
To explain all the possible risks and the yes, complications sir. Which can happen.
I'm correct. Only talking about the heading. I'm not talking yes. about the wordings. Heading cannot be consent for death.
Yes.
Because
heading. Only talking about the terminology, heading. Not
what?
The contents.
I think
definitely you should mention.
We are close to our short of time. We'll move on to the next question, sir. Quickly, Dr. Senthil has his second question to ask.
Morning, everybody. Good morning, sir. I am Dr. Senthil Nathan, senior assistant professor.
Second question.
Hello, sir.
Second question, yes.
In our scenario, as a referral, a tertiary referral cath center, a medical college hospital, usually most of the obstetric cases are tried outside in the private hospitals as well as in a government hospital, and is referred to the medical college hospital late. And so, give anesthesia and do the surgery. And most of the cases, nearly the mortality and morbidity is nearly about more than 40% to 50% here in the tertiary care center. And so if something happens to the patient and the patient's attender goes for a litigation, and who will be really responsible? Whether will it be the people in the tertiary care center, or will it be the people in the other government hospitals? And moreover, even here in the government hospital, it is because all the maternal mortality cases goes for a highest review to the central government, and the review is done. And even the anesthetist is called for, though it is a more often a surgical problem, the anesthetist also called for a review. And I really want to know if at all the litigation goes in favor of the attender side, and will the anesthetist be penalized for this?
Sir, Dr. Chairman, sir, he wants to know. Yeah, you got the question, sir?
No.
He wants to know. Okay. In medical colleges, all are very sick obstetric patients are being referred from nearby town panchayat BHCs and smaller government setup hospitals, or even private hospitals, private hospitals also, to in the terminal stages, like what happens now in COVID time also. They have been shifting the terminally ill COVID patients to medical colleges. That is what our health minister also was trying to discourage the private hospitals not to do it. Similarly, he wants to know if these patients are brought in the last stage, and if there is any event happen, it is notified to the highest authority, maternal mortality, particularly obstetric related maternal mortality. Who is responsible? Is the primary hospital which could not manage the case in entirety, or the tertiary referral hospital? Who is responsible, is asked, for the mishap?
So this issue is decided by the court of law as timely referral. So timely referral is very, very important. This is decided by the notes of the referring hospital, the discharge notes and the referral letter, as well as the admission notes of the second hospital. So it is decided by discharge notes of the referring hospital and referral letter, as well as the admission notes of the second hospital. So I think I am clear what I'm telling. In what condition the patient was referred, that brings in the decision. I mean, clear or okay, something
else?
Clear.
Yes, sir.
Yes, very clear. Very clear.
Sir, what I mean is, yes,
you need not have any worry because the governmental agencies, they make only inquiries to find out whether there is any negligence. Just because you are called for an inquiry, it does not mean that you are negligent. So, need not worry. It is only a fact-finding exercise by the government to see whether the patient has been dealt with properly. That's all.
So, court decides on these issues.
Yes.
In what condition he was referred, in what condition?
That is the point.
Or what has happened on the way.
Yeah, yeah. That's the point.
You are on the way, you have taken steps to manage the case on the way. Because you should refer the patient in an ambulance, in a transportable condition, and in a transportable method. And a doctor should accompany if the patient is really serious. The doctor should maintain a case record even on the transit. Nobody does that. There is case sheet for referring hospital, case sheet for admitting hospital, as well as case sheet maintained in the ambulance.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
We'll go to the next last part of this discussion. We have Dr. Srinivasan, who's a secretary also, secretary of ISA Coimbatore. Basically, a very busy freelance consultant and also owns a hospital. So he wants to know.
Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Srinivas. My first question to Dr. Chiran, in the event of any intraoperative mishap, what are all the rights of patient side to demand records, case sheets, etc.? Does the hospital have the right to refuse them? And if required, whom to hand over the records? Whether to the attenders itself or to their. On what basis a case is decided a civil or a criminal case? Can a criminal arrest warrant be issued against doctors?
He has put in 2-3 questions in one, sir. Basically, he wants
to ask one by one.
Yeah, record. He wants to know if any critical event has happened, patients or relatives and everybody demands first case and records. Can we hand it over to them or the hospital has the right to refuse? We can't give it. Or if so, whom to give the records, if at all demanded?
The issues regarding medical records has never been a law. It is not decided by the law. It had been decided well by the Medical Council of India. We know we have got our code of ethics. In that code of ethics, Medical Council of India has stipulated that any legal heir or authorized representative or a patient, because in a death case, only a legal heir or an authorized representative can ask for records, or the patient ask for records, the total records should be given within 72 hours. This is a medical code of ethics, not law. So based on this medical code of ethics, law has arisen now. Citing the medical code of ethics, the courts have found fault if you are not issued the records within 72 hours. To whom issue? Authorized representative or legal heir. Within how much of time? 72 hours. How much? Total case record. There is no escapism in this. I think first question is clear.
Yes, very clear, sir. And second question, second part he wants to know, what decides whether a case should be a civil or a criminal case? On what basis the decision made by whom?
I don't understand the question, please.
If at all any mishap happens,
okay.
What, if at all any hospital mishap happening,
okay.
So what basis the decision to proceed as a civil or a criminal case is taken into account? Who decides which type of case to file? Is it the patient's relatives, police, or who decides?
Unfortunately, patient relatives decide, because it is your right to knock the door of the court wherever you want, whichever court you want. But so if you want to knock the door of civil court, you can knock the door. If you want to knock the door of criminal court, you can knock the criminal court. If you want to knock the door of consumer court, you can knock the consumer court. If you want to knock the doors of government, you can knock the doors of government. If you want to knock the door of MCA, you can knock the door of MCA. So patient decides. But how it is decided whether it is civil or criminal, the criminal negligence is criminal. Otherwise, everything is civil. Criminal negligence means there are certain stipulations by which it will be considered as criminal negligence, like operating on the wrong patient, operating on the wrong limb, operating wrongly, like that. These are all giving wrong blood. All these things are criminal negligence. So automatically, in criminal court, criminal negligence will be looked after. In all the other courts, civil or criminal, civil or consumer, it is for the patient to decide. Patient even can knock the doors of the magistrate, but magistrate will decide later, depending upon the case, whether it is a criminal case to be tried in criminal court or it is a civil case to be tried in civil court.
So he wants to know, can an arrest warrant based on the suspicion be issued on the doctors immediately?
Yes. Suppose
following a mishap.
Yes. Before 2005, there was one golden landmark judgment to benefit doctors in Jacob Matthew versus the state of Punjab. The Supreme Court case, which happened in 2005. Before that, anybody can file any criminal case against the doctor. Even any police officer can arrest any doctor, provided the case has been registered or FIR filed. Now, after 2005, the Supreme Court has told two things. One, an FIR against the doctor or an hospital can be registered only after an expert body finds prima facie negligence in the case. So straight away, an FIR cannot be registered. FIR, before being registered, the complaint should be referred to a medical college dean to form a committee, or to MCA, or to, if it is a private case, to a specialist of the same specialty, it should be referred. That specialist or the dean or the MCA should find some prima facie evidence in the case. Then only FIR can be registered. This is first part. Second thing, even if a FIR is registered, a doctor cannot be arrested in a routine manner. This routine is an important word. In a routine manner, the doctor cannot be arrested. But in certain situations, the doctor can be arrested. Not routinely. Normally, in 90% of the cases, doctor may not be arrested. So what I suggest you, every doctor should have this Jacob Matthew judgment over his table to prove two things, because the police inspector may not know the law. Two things. One, FIR should not be routinely filed against the doctor if there is a criminal complaint. Two, even if FIR is filed, it cannot be, arrest cannot be fashioned in a routine manner. So suppose if an FIR is filed, you can approach the court for quash of FIR.
Okay, sir. That is nice. Yes, sir. Very clear. Absolutely clear. So let me go on to last few more questions from Srinivasan. I'll go to that.
Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Srinivas. Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Srinivas. My first question to
Dr. Srinivasan.
Yeah.
Issued against doctors.
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Srinivas.
Srini is talking the same question.
My first.
Srini is live.
Yeah.
He can ask questions live.
Yeah, Srini, I will second question of Dr. Srinivasan quickly. Srini, you can ask or you want me to check?
No, I think my second question is already question by Sendil Nada nearly.
Yes, yes, yes. Almost.
Yeah, you're right.
So, referred from higher center, it has been already answered. So, another question is, the next thing is, if suppose any procedure-related post-operative neurological problems, both Yagamram and Srinivasan has asked same question. Yes. The minor neurological problem, something like after a regional anesthesia, spinal anesthesia, patient has sensory deficit, some kind of a problem in the nerve functioning, some weakness, all that happens. And legal proceedings for the entire hospital or the doctors, or how does it proceed, sir, for any post-operative neurological problems?
Sir, actually,
routine procedure, maybe.
Yeah. Fine. Post-operative neurological deficit happens when there is an injury to the nerve trunk by the needle used by the anesthetist. Or it happens because of compression or stretching or things like that due to faulty positioning. So all these things are the responsibility of the anesthetist during a particular case to protect the patient from the harmful effects of positioning, giving padding here and there, and taking care to see that the nerve plexuses or the individual nerves are not compressed or stretched. All these things are the responsibility of the anesthetist. Similarly, but a little bit of paresthesia or tingling and pins and needle sensation in the post-operative period may not count as negligence, because many of the consent forms mention this particular complication when they get a consent for regional anesthesia. I have seen that in many hospitals, post-operative neuropraxia complications like tingling or neurological deficit may happen. But if the patient has total paralysis of a particular nerve, then the anesthetist will be held liable. And I don't think there is any role for hospital in this particular, except a vicarious liability for engaging your services. So the main thrust of the complication, I mean, the liability will be on the individual anesthetist who did not take proper care of the patient during surgery. I think, Dr. Srinivasan, sir?
If the surgeon wants to have a lithotomy position, say, yes. prolonged surgery, given yes, all the padding and all the adequate precautions, but in spite yes. of that, does the surgery for a prolonged time without even considering the possibility of another injury. So, will it not be a shared responsibility?
Yes, sir, definitely. Such things happen, sir, actually. Actually, such things happen very frequently. But here, what will happen is, it will depend on the notions of the individual judge and also on the facts and the circumstances of each case. So, whether you can, of course, point out in your defense that there was extreme lithotomy for the sake of surgeon's convenience, and then the surgery was a prolonged one. Patient is a diabetic, so prone for these neurological complications. All those things can be brought out in your argument, but you may have to, some amount of liability will certainly fall on you as an anesthetist. I hope Dr. Charan sir will agree with these points.
Everyone's responsibility and liability is decided case to case basis.
Yes.
So I think more or less we have completed. Yes. One question, sir. Many of the out of time surgeries, say patient wants to have cesarean at 12 midnight, or the surgeon is very busy, traveling surgeon wants to operate in the middle of the night, wherein the optimal care to the patient may not be delivered by the anesthesiologist, who is not such fresh enough to provide the care like a morning case. So in which circumstance any problem happens, the patient attenders or relatives might point out that they operated at the very wrong time and because of which a problem has happened. Are we having any defense in that, or we are liable for doing the surgery in the wrong time?
I had one sort of this case from Tirunelveli, where the doctor was very, very busy. Surgeon is very, very busy. He normally operates between 12 and 3. Midnight 12 to morning 3, normally operates. That too after seeing 200 OP patients. So the case was, this complication has arisen because the doctor had taken up surgery during the sleeping hours, and because doctor was very tired after seeing 200 OP patients. So this was the case as well as the argument by the complainant advocate. the court said definitely the issue of fatigability is always there. So once you get fatigue, you are bound to make mistakes. You are bound to be negligent. So this is an issue definitely to be considered when you are doing surgery, when you are seeing so many number of patients in a day.
Thank you, sir. I think advice is to operate well within the acceptable time frame of being fresh to operate on patients. And another last question, sir, before we ask you to concluding messages. One is, there is suppose one patient which was well managed and developed some known complication and became very bad and sick. And this patient was referred to another tertiary center, patient doing very well there, and postoperatively after 2 days, patient was recovered well and goes home. And within a matter of few days later, patient develops a complication like a neurological problem. And patient was assessed and said it is because of the first surgery during which time he had a problem. So patient comes back and sends a legal suit to the first hospital. So is it what way they can defend? Because the first case was managed and they transferred the patient safely. Patient did well, discharged home, walked back, and then developed neurological problems. And they're complaining now. So how do the doctors defend in this circumstance? Well, I don't have much details to give you about this case, but this is a happening case.
But which doctor has to be defended? First hospital or
yes.
Second
hospital? That is what we want to know, sir. First hospital.
I am an advocate.
The first hospital has to be defended, sir.
Okay. So first hospital has to prove that that is why the discharge summary gains much importance. Because there are two records to speak of your work, whether you have done correct work without any negligence. There are two records, two documents. One is case sheet, another one is discharge summary. People think that, mostly the doctors think that, the case sheet is much more important than the discharge summary. It is otherwise. Case sheet is not so much important as discharge summary, because case sheet is with you. Discharge summary is with the patient. So, discharge summary, you cannot do anything alteration in the discharge summary, whereas everybody knows that you can alter anything with the case sheet. So, whatever you are written in the discharge summary will speak for you, because the document is with the patient. That will speak for you. So, you should have written a proper discharge summary. I have seen discharge summaries where there is no discharge advice, where there is no condition on discharge, where there is no advice over review like that. So those discharge summaries will not speak for you. If you have written the discharge summary in a proper way, like the condition at discharge, how the patient was discharged, in what condition. So, like as you said, he was discharged in a very well condition, right? That has to be established in discharge summary. Second thing, what is the review you asked for? Third thing, what is the discharge advice you are given him? So all these three things will tell your good work. If the records are paka and you are really, your work is also paka, I don't think you will be landing up in trouble.
Thank you very much, sir. I think we are running short of time.
I think you left one question about that cardiac.
I know, Senthil, because of paucity of time. Quickly, there are episodes that patient, very sick cardiac patients, sir, and some people, all patients are taken a cardiac advice, cardiac opinion, and high risk. In high risk cardiac patients undergoing surgery other than for heart surgery, non-cardiac surgery, is there a necessity to have a cardiologist along with you during the time of the operation? Because some relatives, they say, our cardiologist is ready to come and stay during the time of surgery. So is it mandatory, legally required, a cardiologist also to be present during the high-risk cardiac patient undergoing some non-cardiac surgery? Say, for example, you can undergo cataract. But during that time, is it necessary to have a cardiologist along with you? Is it absolutely essential, sir?
it depends upon the consent. In the consent, if you have mentioned there might be some cardiac events, there might be some cardiac problems which are going to occur in a more percentage, then it is better that you have a cardiologist with you. If your consent does not run up to any cardiac difficulties, complications, then if the patient is going to insist, you are not against that, you can always have it. It is not mandatory. But if the patient insists, you can have it. No problem.
Patient insisting patients we have, but patients who don't know anything about it.
That is what? It depends upon your counseling and consent.
Right.
Suppose you are touched upon cardiology in every way and you have written the consent in such a way that there may be cardiac tamponade, there may be cardiac failure, there may be so many cardiac events. Then there is no justification in refusing cardiologist when you have said there might be so many cardiac events in consent.
But cardiology,
it is logical.
But the cardiologist is available, sir.
It depends upon the consent. Once you have written such a consent to save yourself from the clutches of the law, then it is important that you have the cardiologist with you.
But it is not practical every time.
Last, you have anticipated, this is your guess, you have informed the patient also that this might happen, but why is that you did not have the cardiologist stand by? What will be your defense then?
But is that, has it happened, sir? Such kind of a problem? Demand,
no, the issue is, I will tell.
Hypothetically can happen.
Of our consent obtained in hospitals are not enough, are not adequate. So this issue will never arise because we never have the habit of getting correct consent.
SNK, sir?
Yes, sir. This problem is a very practical problem, but the presence of a cardiologist is not an antidote against occurrence of cardiac events, nor is he the best person to treat the cardiac event during anesthesia. A cardiologist deals with the patient during a normal condition, stress-free. But during anesthesia, there is the additional stress of anesthesia and surgery, and anesthetist is the best person to tackle any complications that happen. So what he has to do is, he has to manage the things to the best of his ability and then transfer the case to the cardiologist for further management. The presence of a cardiologist cannot be mandated. So far, I think, but some judges have their own notions. That's where the difficulty comes in. They have their own ideas, their own notions about how things should be managed. And in their, in their limited knowledge of medicine and surgery and the way of working of the hospital, they say certain things, but it is not practical. It's not practical to have a cardiologist. The surgeon may run for 3 or 4 hours. Cardiologist is a physician, and he may not be able to stand with you just guessing at the ECG monitor or taking the pulse of the patient. Only the anesthetist is the best person to manage anything that happens within the operating theater.
I think so. We'll conclude with that, sir. Thank you so much. Closing remarks from both the experts, Dr. Chiran and this thing. How best to proceed if there is any event has happened, or how to safeguard yourself from any of these critical events?
First, I will say, sir, with the permission of Dr. Chiran, see, we have to follow standard procedures, standard practice, pre-anesthetic examination, recording of all our findings, a good contemporaneous, accurate, and complete intraoperative record, and a remark in the post-operative period that everything is okay, well, patient is alive and well, and then a reasonable degree of care to the patient. And any problem that happens, we have to look at it through the patient's own viewpoint. His safety, his well-being, his recovery are more important than any other inconvenience that we may face in the anesthetic management. So everything should be tuned to the benefit of the patient rather than to avoid certain inconveniences for our own selves. So if we do that, then we will always be safe.
Chiran, sir. Your advice?
So as bullet points, first one is infrastructure. Two, I'll tell only the points. First one is infrastructure. Two, qualification and competence. Three, as I told you, equipments in working and calibrated condition. Four, pre-anesthetic assessment. 5, counseling and informed consent. 6, documentation like anesthesia chart and notes. 7, if there is any problem, ask for help, because the court considers two persons are better than one. Finally, if something problematic has occurred, always ask for postmortem. On table death has to be intimated to the police. It is a must, 100%. If there is an on table death, it has to be intimated to the police. Then ask for postmortem. Then writing notes is very important. Documentation is very important. During the critical stages, court expects every notes in every 20 minutes. Every 20 minutes, there has to be one note. Because very often I find doctors saying that, sir, I was all along present in the theater. I was all along present in the labor ward. I was all along present in ICU. I was all along present by the side of the patient. But there is no notes. It will not speak about your presence. So there should be notes. In a critically ill patient, court expects every 20 minutes or every half an hour notes. So wherever there is problem, there is difficulty in condition, you bring it into writing. There was some difficulty in this. Suppose there is going to be a difficult airway. Write, bring it into the case sheet that there was difficult airway. Likewise, if you deviate, so two things you have to note in case sheet documentation. One is difficult conditions. Second one is when you deviate from the routine, when you deviate from the normal. Bring it in writing. So all these things will save you. So proper documentation and proper communication. I think if you follow all these bullet points, if you follow all these guidelines, you will have a very safe anesthetic practice. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Sudarshan, are you there?
Sudarshan, sir, come me.
Okay.
No, yes, I am there. Just, I'm on my mobile now. My internet was not very stable. Thank you so much for both experts. Dr. SMK, in spite of his demand to attend another meeting at 1:30, he joined us and stayed till, because we are enthusiasm. We were delaying. Normally, we finish it at 1 o'clock. Now it's 1:15 beyond. And Dr. Charan, no words to express thanks to your presence. And very, very crystal clear explanation of all the questions. Thank you so much, both the experts. I have no words to express. Big thanks to both of you with the folded hands. Thank you, sir. Over to Dr. Edward and Kripa to conclude further.
Thank you, sir. So thank you, both the esteemed experts, Dr. Chairman and Dr. Krishnamurthy, and also the moderator, Dr. Sudarshan, and the expert panelist. With that, we come to the end of this EME of this academic session. At this juncture, I also remember and thank the other expert scholars of our past CMEs. Without their support, our CME would not have been a popular one. I have seen consistently our CME has attended by more than 250 participants every week. So I also thank our beloved dynamic secretary, Kripa Haran, and the captain of this academic event, our honorable president, Dr. Sudarshan, and our president-elect, Dr. Kumar, who always stood by my side while planning these CMEs. I thank Kumar also. And I also thank Dr. Ratna Kumar for giving support from the background. And I also thank all the city's branch presidents and secretaries for your excellent cooperation for the success of the CMEs. I thank one and all, and over to secretary.
Thank you, Dr. Edward. It was a wonderful program, as usual. Now I invite our Coimbatore ISA secretary, Dr. Srinivasan, to give the branch report.
Good afternoon, everybody. Hope you all had a good session today. Pre-COVID, the ISA Coimbatore was conducting monthly CME meet regularly, an attendance of around 50 to 60 attendees minimum. But during COVID, during the strict lockdown, we managed to purchase face shields, PPE kits, N95 masks, and distributed it to the Coimbatore Medical College and ESI anesthesia department whenever required. Now we are conducting a monthly Zoom meeting regularly, and we also had a few international speakers also. I thank the state office bearers for giving ISA Coimbatore this opportunity for hosting. Happy Pongal and thank you all.
Thank you, Srinivas.
Sirap.
Thank you, Sini. Now we'll move on to vote of thanks. I thank both kitchen moderators, Dr. Shekhar, Dr. Chairan, Dr. S.N. Krishnamurthy, and the speakers, Dr. Amar, and all the inquisitors of the second program. A big thank you from Tamil Nadu ISA for the successful conduct of this event. Now I wish all of them a happy Pongal holidays, and see you in the next. We have not planned our next program yet, so we will come out soon with our next program. So till then, goodbye to all of you from Tamil Nadu ISA. Thank you so much.
Thank you all of you. Bye. Thank you. Wonderful effort. Everything. A1 Logics. Most importantly,
Kripa.
A1 Logics has been backbone for conducting all these events. Praveen, Shilpa, and the entire team. I think there is no words to appreciate them. Excellent. Every meet has been up to the point. Professional skill has been very well managed, and everybody, absolute wonderful technical team backing up. Thank you so much, A1 Logics, and thanks everyone.
Bye.
And we'll meet in the summit meeting. Thank you. Bye.
Shilpa, thank you all. Fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you.